Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I am Dr. Jameel Abbas from the Physiology Department of the Faisalabad Medical University, and today's lecture is in continuation with your endocrinology, and we were moving toward the diabetic complications. As I have told you in the previous lecture, that what are the complications of the diabetes, and we have discussed some pathophysiology behind that complication. One of the very important pathophysiology of those complication is the glycation. Actually, the glycation is a different thing and glycosylation is a different thing. In the diabetic patient, this is non-enzymatic glycation of the proteins occur. That non-enzymatic glycation is quite different as compared to the glycosylation. Glycosylation is an enzymatic joining of the sugar with a protein or with an amino acid, while the glycation, that is a non-enzymatic attachment of a sugar molecule, particularly the glucose to a protein or the amino acid, is known as the glycation. This is non-enzymatic and this is a pathological one. This glycation, which is a pathological process, while the glycosylation is a physiological process. So the end result of the process of the glycation is the formation of the advanced glycation end products, and these are the highly dangerous things, and multiple problems or multiple, you can say, the complication of diabetes is because of the formation of this advanced glycation end products, that is an attachment of a sugar molecule, that is a glucose, to a protein or the amino acid. Actually, what is the problem here? These advanced AGE products, advanced glycation end products, they cross-link with the proteins and different from the livers and inactivate them. And you know that the proteins are present everywhere, in every enzyme on the basement membrane, they are present. So these advanced glycation end products, they cross-react with the proteins and lipids and inactivate them or make them essentially non-functional. And when this advanced glycation products are present, due to the excessive glucose in your body, because extra glucose, that we need glucose every time, because your brain can't survive more than 5 minutes without glucose. The only source of energy for your brain is glucose, but we need a glucose in within a limit. But once your glucose level is beyond that limit, that is more than that one, that extra liver act as a extra, that means glucose or hyperglycemia or extra glucose, this act as a toxic substance. And there are multiple ways through which it is going to react with different things. One of them is the advanced glycation end products. We have seen the previous reaction, previous lecture, that ultimately due to the different processes, nitric oxide production is reduced due to the production of the reactive oxygen species. Ultimately, we have reduced the production of the nitric oxide, and ultimately there was a vasoconstriction and different processes starts from there. And we have seen in the previous lecture also that there is a form of glucose can move through the endothelial cells without insulin. So extra glucose moves inside the epithelial cells, and then the monocytes, they again move inside, and the LDL moves inside. Ultimately, foam cells are formed, and when these foam cells are formed, they break up and they damage your endothelium from behind. Tunica intima is damaged, so that's why the your hyperglycemia is going to damage through multiple ways. One was the hyperglycemia and managing the movement of increasing the permeability of your endothelium and the movement of the your macrophages, monocytes inside, the LDL inside, the ultimately foam cell formation and damage to the endothelium, behind the endothelium. While keep in mind, the hypertension is going to damage your endothelium in front. It's going to damage the endothelium from the front, but the diabetes is usually going to damage it from behind also. So next slide, you will see that what are the effects of this increased glycosylation. What are the effects of this one? Actually, ultimately, the main thing is from this one, this advanced glycosylation, when there is advanced glycosylation end products, they are going to entangle with the different types of proteins, and they are going to entangle with the lipids and make them, there are chances of atherosclerosis or more, and then the basement membrane is going to be thickened. And this is what happens in a diabetic patient. And diabetic patient glucose basement membrane is going to thick one. So multiple processes are going to affect your during the time of your diabetes. That excessive of the glucose, excess of the glucose is acting as a toxic substance in multiple ways. And this is a diagram for the your diabetic foot. This is again diabetic foot. I have told you in the previous one. This is how the pathophysiology of this one. And you have seen all these things. Then insulin resistance, we have seen actually it's beyond your limit how the insulin resistance is going to occur. Then the metabolic changes in the diabetes. What are the metabolic changes in diabetes? First of all, this is the fat catabolism. You know that while the insulin is present, it tries to store the fat in the form of triglycerides. It tries to synthesize the fat. But when the insulin is not there, the diabetes is there, there's excess of the glucose is present, then that insulin cannot, that glucose cannot be utilized as a source of energy, then fats come forward and there is increased catabolism of the fat that will lead to the free fatty acid in the blood and the liver. Then due to these fatty acids, the acetyl-CoA is formed much more as compared to the normal one, and it will lead to the increased formation of the cholesterol and risk of atherosclerosis there. Then excessive ketone bodies are there. These excessive ketone bodies, although they act as a source of energy for your brain, but if they are more, then it may lead to the diabetic ketoacidosis. DKA is a very important complication. We are going to see it soon. Then the catabolism of the tissue proteins due to the energy requirement, because glucose can't uptake by the cell. It will lead to the, when the catabolism of the tissue protein is going to occur, it will lead to the weight loss and increase in the level of the amino acids in the blood and more formation of urea by the deamination of the amino acids. These are the metabolic changes occurring in the diabetes. And this diagram, here is the pathogenesis of the diabetic ketoacidosis. How the diabetic ketoacidosis is going to damage you. I am going to compare another slide what is the difference between diabetic ketoacidosis and hyperosmolar hyperglucose or hyperglycemic state, HHS, the hyper. I will see you later on, you will see soon in the next diagram. But here is the pathogenesis of the diabetic ketoacidosis. Actually, keto means ketone bodies. Acidosis means more hydrogen. Whenever the acids are more, they liberate hydrogen. And hydrogen ion is highly dangerous for your body because hydrogen ion has not an electron. It's going to react with your all the enzymes and proteins. So excess of the acid or extra acids are highly dangerous for our body. It may lead to the acidosis. When you will study the kidney, you will study in detail the acidosis. Some acids, they are beneficial for our body. Some are highly dangerous for our body. The strong acids and weak acids. Weak acid example is your carbonic acid, which is beneficial for your body. Weak acid means these acids have the hydrogen ion, but they are not willing to donate it. They are not willing to release it. They are beneficial for it. While some acids, which are the strong acid, that means HCl, the sulfuric acid, or the acids coming from your ketone body, they are easily liberating the hydrogen ion. This hydrogen ion going to cross it with all your enzymes, your body, and proenzymes of your body. So that's why these acids are, they are dangerous in for you. And these, some of them, they are produced when there is a hyperglycemia. And let's start with this one. That's, for example, in the liver. Increased glucose production. And when there is increased glucose production, that means this increased glucose production is through the gluconeogenesis. Because whenever this gluconeogenesis in the diabetes, what is happening, the glucose is produced and this glucose is leading to the hyperglycemia. On the other side, in the peripheral tissues, glucose is not utilized by the body. When the glucose is not utilized by the body, that will also contribute to the hyperglycemia. And this hyperglycemia, this extra glucose, act as an osmotic diuretic that will lead to the osmotic diuresis. And this is a cardinal symptom of the diabetes, that is a polyuria. That is excessive urine is formed in your diabetic patient, polyuria. And to compensate that water loss, the patient has to drink the water again and again. That is known as the polydipsia. So here is the osmotic diuresis, and this will lead to the volume depletion. On the other side, if you see the adipose tissue, there is increase, there is a breakdown. I have seen you previously that increase breakdown and release the free fatty acids. Then in the liver, increased ketogenesis. That means ketone bodies are formed more and more. When the ketone bodies, they are more, then beta hydroxybutyric acid, then ketones itself, they will lead to the ketoacidosis. Then there's a decreased alkalis. To compensate this acids, the alkalis they are used. So the alkalis reserves are decreased. So what will happen? The metabolic acidosis will be there. And when this metabolic acidosis is there, the patient will represent with the typically acidotic breath. That means whenever there is excessive hydrogen in your body, this hydrogen in your body is going to stimulate the chemosensitive area in your medulla. That chemosensitive area in your medulla will cause a hyperventilation. And this hyperventilation, if the patient represents with the hyperventilation, if the patient will become dyspneic, hyperventilation patient came to you in the hospital, and you may smell the ketone bodies. Smell of the ketone bodies is quite different. You can sense it. If you smell the breath of the patient suffering from the diabetic ketosis, at the same time the patient is dehydrated also. So the dehydration, hyperglycemia, and the presence of the ketone bodies in the urine, or you can calculate the ketone bodies in the plasma. If those things are present, you can easily diagnose the patient. But keep in mind, don't give immediately the potassium to those patients, because there is a hyperkalemia is also present in this patient, but this is extracellular potassium is there and you are measuring to that one. But when you give insulin to this patient, insulin causes the movement of potassium back to the intracellular. So we give the potassium, but later on after the calculation, after giving the insulin to those patients. Next is this is again the pathophysiology of those which we have seen the previous slide. This is again the same thing, metabolic consequence of diabetic ketosis. This is not considered. You must understand that there is a acidosis is there, and this acidosis, loss of electrolytes are different. They are the different things, but they are beyond your limit. Insulin resistance, don't move to these things. Then hyperosmolar hyperglycemic state, HHS. This is again a complication, HHS. It's mostly, and now the basic difference is in the end, in the diabetic ketoacidosis, approximately there is no insulin. But in hyperinsulin, hyperosmolar hyperglycemic state, there is a relative insulin presence. Insulin is, some amount of insulin is there. Whenever there is some amount of insulin there, then the ketones are not formed. So this, which is the basic difference. So hyperosmolar hyperglycemic state is mostly initiated by the infection, myocardial infarction, stroke, or another acute illnesses. So due to the insulin deficiency, plasma glucose may rise above 600 mg per deciliter, and which may lead to the high serum osmolarity that may lead above than 320 milliosmolar. And it will cause polyuria. Again, the same symptom which is occurring in the diabetic ketosis, DKA. Polyuria is there. There is excessive urination because of excess of the glucose act as an osmotic diuretic. Same sentence. You must know that the extra glucose act as an osmotic diuretic. It will cause volume depletion, high hemoconcentration that further increase the blood glucose level. Now ketosis is absent because it's very important differentiating point between HHS and your DK, that ketosis is absent in the HHS because the presence of some insulin inhibit hormone sensitive lipase mediated fat tissue breakdown. This is very important sentence. Keep in mind of how you can differentiate between the HHS state and DKA. Here in this slide you can compared the both the diabetic ketoacidosis and the your HHS. In diabetic ketosis, on this side you will see absolute insulin deficiency. It will cause the lipolysis. It will increase the lipolysis, that is the breakdown of your fats, lipolysis. It will increase the free fatty acids. These free fatty acids, they will act as a substrate for the gluconeogenesis. On the other side, they will lead to the formation of the ketone bodies. Alkali reserve will be decreased in ketoacidosis. Triglycerols. We have seen all these things in the previous slide, and here the triglycerol is addition which is formed. It will lead to the hyperlipidemia, and this all is ketone bodies are formed that will lead to the ketoacidosis. We will limit in the previous slide up to here. But here an additional that thing is the more when the fatty acids are more, they may lead to the formation of triglycerol, and there is hyperlipidemia is there. But on the other side, as you move the counter-regulatory hormone, that is mainly the counter-regulatory hormone with the glucagon, the protein synthesis decrease, proteolysis there, ultimately gluconeogenesis. They both these things they will act as a gluconeogenic substrate. And on the same side, free fatty acids they are also coming in line in front action. So protein proteolysis, increased fatty acids, they will act for the as a substrate for the gluconeogenesis. So the gluconeogenesis is going to increase. On the other side, the breakdown of glycogen is also going to occur. So glucose utilization is decreased because insulin is not there. So ultimately, all these three factors will contribute in the hyperglycemia. So this hyperglycemia is very important. That if the question is asked to you, what are the different forms of what are the different contributing factors in the hyperglycemia? So very important, because the glucose is not utilized, it will contribute in the hyperglycemia. Second is gluconeogenesis increase, it will cause the hyperglycemia. Second, the breakdown of the glucose, that glycogen, increased glycogenolysis, that will lead to the hyperglycemia. And ultimately, it will lead to the same thing, glycosuria, loss of water, electrolyte, dehydration, impaired renal function, and ultimately it will lead to the hyperosmolarity. So in the HHS, actually there is a relative, although this HHS is not written there, but there is a relative insulin deficiency. That's why in the HHS, you have seen the previous slide that some insulin is there and the ketone body's production is not there. Here in all these scenarios, you will not see in the ketoacidosis. Ketoacidosis is written here. So HHS and the DKA, both are the complications of the hyperglycemia, the diabetes, uncontrolled diabetes. DKA is also stimulated usually due to the fever, infections. This lead to the DKA, diabetic ketoacidosis. In diabetic ketoacidosis is more common in the type 1 diabetes. There is absolute deficit. Type 1 diabetic patient, they are more suffering to the ketoacidosis. So you can well understand by this slide the difference between these two and previous slide. Here is the difference between DKA and HS. Most of them, I have told you, the type 1 diabetic patient, they are more suffering from the DKA, while HHS is more common in the type 2 diabetes. Blood sugar level is just above the 250. Here the blood sugar level is maybe up to the 600. Then acetone breath, that is the acetone is a type of ketone body. It may be present in your breath, I have told you earlier. But here is no, this acetone actually has got a fruity breath, but here is no fruity smell. Then the ketone body, they are present in urine. Here is no ketone bodies, or they are minimum. The rest of things, cosmol respiration. I have told you that the patient is suffering from the different types of breathing, which is known as cosmol breathing, and this is due to the high release of hydrogen ion from the your acetoacetic acid or ketone body. They are releasing hydrogen ion. This hydrogen ion is going to stimulate your medullary centers, especially the chemotactic receptive area, and it will stimulate your dorsal group of neurons, which causes the hyperventilation. Here is a shallow breathing. Then this DKA developed quickly, while the HHS developed very slowly. Then severely altered, your LOC, they are severely altered, while here the nausea, vomiting, and your abdominal pain is there. Then here, main thing is the profound dehydration, a very important thing to differentiate between these two, the glucose level, presence of the acid in the body, and profound dehydration. So these are the differences between the DKA and the HHS. Then we move to the another very important complication of the diabetes, that is hypoglycemia. Actually, hypoglycemia is connected with a hormone, that is glucagon. Because you are living between the two states, one state is headed by your hyperglycemia, or one state is headed by the insulin. You can say when you are in a fed state, your insulin is going to head your body. Within 3 to 5 minutes, it will work it. But after that, glucose is responsible to provide the glucagon is responsible to provide the glucose to your body during fasting state. It is the responsibility of the glucagon, because glucagon actions are quite opposite to the insulin. Mainly the function of the glucagon is to do what? That is the increase gluconeogenesis. The main function of the glucagon is the gluconeogenesis. So in this slide you can see that you will see this hyperglycemia, the glucagon like peptides, amino acids. Whenever there is hyperglycemia, alpha cells of the your pancreas, islets of Langerhans, there are two types, there are different cells. One of them is alpha cell. Alpha cell produces a glucagon. Glucagon means glue, means glucose, ga means gone. So there is no glucose. Glucose has gone. Glucagon. It is going whenever there is a hypoglycemia, there is no glucose. At that time, glucagon will come in an action. It will provide the glucose to your body. And the main site of action is your liver. It will cause the gluconeogenesis to provide the insulin, to provide the glucose to your body. We'll see in the next slide. They have the symptoms, different symptoms of the hypoglycemia. Why is the hypoglycemia here? Hypoglycemia is usually due to two things. One is when the patient is taking the insulin, is take the overdose of the insulin by mistake. Or sometimes what happens, you have taken the insulin and you miss the breakfast, you miss your meals. You have taken the insulin, you set up for a journey, and you miss your breakfast or your lunch. You have got the insulin in your body. That insulin begins to work, and all your glucose is utilized. But after that, because you are not taking any meal, you move to the hypoglycemic state. Keep in mind, the hypoglycemia usually starts when your glucose level decreases below 50 mg per deciliter. The symptom starts and patient may become unconscious because your brain is not receiving glucose, which is the main source of energy for the brain. So patient may not only become unconscious, but the mental dysfunctions are also there when the glucose level begins to decline below the 50 mg per deciliter. And what are the different symptoms? And the autonomic and symptoms are there. That means the palpitation is there. Patient feels the palpitation, the sweating. Then there's an anxiety, palpitation, sweating, tingling, trembling, hypoglycemic unawareness. Sometimes the patient don't know that he is suffering from the hypoglycemia. Then neurological glycopenia, irritability, drowsiness, dizziness, blurred vision, difficulty with speech, confusion, feeling of faint. All these are symptoms of your hypoglycemia. When your excessive insulin is there and glucose is not there, so that will lead to the hypoglycemia. Now here is one very important point. The hypoglycemia developed due to the oral medicines, that is not the insulin, but the oral drugs which you are taking to reduce your hyperglycemia. If you take the extra dose of that one, then that hypoglycemia is more dangerous. And what is the treatment for this? Actually, the standard given for the hospital management is that when the patient become unconscious and there is a history of diabetic patient, so at that time you don't know the patient is suffering from the hypoglycemia or hyperglycemia. You have to give the insulin, you have to give the glucose immediately to that patient. Because if there is hyperglycemia, it may aggravate your hyperglycemia, but hyperglycemia is not going to kill your patient immediately or not causing any derangements immediately. But hypoglycemia, it can lead to the death within minutes and hours. It will lead to the mental derangements within hours. So that's why you have to treat the hypoglycemia on top priority as compared to the hyperglycemia. They are different, they are not concerned with you. Now the glucagon. Again, back to the glucagon. The one sentence is enough for the glucagon, that this is the mechanism of action of glucagon. But glucagon is doing all the functions which are opposite to the insulin. The main function of the glucagon is to do the gluconeogenesis for the production of the glucose for your body. So what is the mechanism of action? The glucagon receptors are there that will lead to stimulation of adenyl cyclase, its formation of the cyclic AMP. It will stimulate the protein kinase C. Then cyclic AMP dependent protein kinase is formed. It will cause the phosphorylation of the inactive phosphorylase B, which is inactive previously, and it will utilize 1 ATP, convert it to the ADP, and the phosphorylase B, this active form is formed, and it will cause stimulate the glycogen, and it will glycogen breakdown will occur, and it will release the glucose. This is very, very brief how the glucagon is going to cause the release of glucose, which is highly important, particularly in a state of hypoglycemia. That was a time. There was a time when the glucagon injections were available in the market just to treat the hypoglycemia. These are again the same things. The glucagon, its function. The glucagon is a hormone secreted by the alpha cells, islets of Langerhans. When the glucose level falls, has a several functions that dramatically this diametrically is not the proper word, dramatically opposed to those of insulin. Most important of these functions is to increase the blood glucose concentration, an effect that is exactly opposite to the insulin. Like insulin, glucagon is a large polypeptide, is composed of the 29 amino acids. Glucagon is also called hyperglycemic hormone. When glucose level is too high, glucagon activates the adipose cell. These are again different mechanism of actions. Glucagon activates adipose cells lipase, so high levels of free fatty acids are available for the energy purpose. Glucagon inhibits the storage of triglycerides in the liver, so liver does not remove the free fatty acids from the blood. Then again, free fatty acids are used for the energy. Glucagon enhances the strength of the heart, increase the blood flow to the kidney and other tissue, enhance the bile secretion, inhibit the gastric acid secretion. These are different functions, but keep in mind the main function is the release of glucose from the liver by doing the gluconeogenesis. Then regulation of the glucagon secretion. Hypoglycemia is the most powerful stimulus for the glucagon secretion. Hypoglycemia, while the hyperglycemia is a stimulation for the release of the insulin. Above 110 mg per deciliter is a stimulus for the release of insulin. But hypoglycemia is most powerful. Hypoglycemia is a broad term. Actually, when your sugar level is below 70, because 70 to 120 is a normal range. In the fed state, you can say up to the 140, 145. So 70 to 140, 150 is a normal range for the glucose level. When your glucose level going to below down your 70, then some people may develop the hypoglycemia. And the old diabetic patient, older, in which the neuropathies are, especially the autonomic neuropathies are there. Autonomic neuropathy, the autonomic nervous system is damaged by the hyperglycemia that lead to the autonomic neuropathy. Autonomic neuropathy, actually, your erectile dysfunction, the diabetic, is due to the autonomic neuropathy. Some cardiac patient, they don't feel the chest pain in case of myocardial infarction. So this is silent myocardial infarction without any pain is also due to the autonomic neuropathy. Excessive sweating, palpitations, again due to the autonomic problems in the hyperglycemia. Here we are basically concerned with the hypoglycemia, so let's move back to the hypoglycemia. It is the most powerful stimulus for the glucagon secretion. Increased amino acids, particularly the alanine and the arginine, stimulate the secretion of both glucagon and insulin. Exercise increases glucagon secretion 4 to 5 times more. Somatostatin from the delta cell, same as coming from the hypothalamus, to inhibit the growth hormone, it also inhibits both insulin and glucagon. Somatostatin acts locally in the islets of Langerhans to inhibit the secretion of insulin and the glucagon. Somatostatin decreases the motility of the stomach and duodenum, also decreases the absorption process of the GIT. So this is a brief words concerned with the regulation of the glucagon secretions. These are the physiological actions of the glucagon. That is the glucagon on the glucose. It is going to increase the glucose level. Why? How? Through gluconeogenesis. On fat, is going to decrease the lipogenesis. That is, lipogenesis is decreased. That means breakdown of lipids will be there, and they will act as fatty acids will act as a substrate for the gluconeogenesis. So glucagon on the insulin stimulates insulin secretion also. There is some reservation upon me because this slide taken from the net. There is some reservation upon this thing. Then here you can see the different things are present. The glucose metabolism increase glycolysis, gluconeogenesis increase on the lipid metabolism, then increase lipolysis, ketogenesis, then protein metabolism, there is a ureagenesis, hepatic amino acid uptake on the energy metabolism, where food intake is decreased and energy expenditure is increased. All these are the functions of the glucagon. That's all about you, and we have finished the pancreas after this one. Thank you very much for joining me. So we have finished all the endocrinology. Because the subjects concerned with the medical sciences, they are very, very broad. And you can add the knowledge by yourself. You have to study the book also, although the lecture is there. But you must study your book, particularly the guide and the Gyano. You must go through those books to add the things, all these things. And thank you very much. We will see you with the next topic. I don't know what will the next topic after the vacation. Thank you very much.